quick introduction. I'm founder and CEO of Above Digital, a digital marketing agency I started in Dubai in 2004, where we help small businesses generate leads and increase their revenues through online campaigns on Google and Facebook. And I also teach digital marketing, where we help brands and business owners learn how to do these things themselves. The difference between others and us is that we are an agency and we teach hands-on training. Today's session is very, very special because it's the last session of this year. We're going to come back next year with lots of fun, more interviews with very inspiring thought leaders and successful entrepreneurs. But let's stick to today's session first. So, you know, we have, I think, 12 days left to 2018.
I've stopped counting. I'm on holiday.
So we have hardly 2 weeks left to 2018. So this time, I call it the reflection time. This is a time when you reflect on 2017. You think about what went right, what did I do correct, so that you keep doing that as the year goes in 2018. What did I, you know, do wrong? Or maybe where can I learn from? And what do I implement next? Very important thing these days is to keep investing in yourselves and in your skills. What new skills did I learn last year? When did I push myself out of the comfort zone? And what are the new things I tried? What were the most happiest moments? What did I enjoy the most in 2017? Where did I learn the most? So this is what I do during the last 2 weeks of the year when I reflect, not only on my personal front, but also on our business front. I'm sure a lot of you are also looking forward to making new goals and new objectives for 2018 for your business as well as for your personal goals. It's so, so important to look at, to reflect and look forward in this time of the year, because unless you don't have a goal, you don't know what path to take, what direction to take. It's so important to have a goal or an objective to look up to. You know, we do this in our digital marketing campaign. We always start backwards. We ask our clients, what do you want? What do you want to achieve from whatever campaign you want? You want new customers, you want repeat business, you want upsell. What exactly is your goal or objective? And based on that, we plan campaigns backwards. Similarly, I think the same rule applies in cycling. Cycling. The same rule applies in life as well. So you plan your goals, whether it's your fitness goals, your personal goals, and your business and revenue goals. And today's session is something to help you to achieve these goals better with my special guest, Yasas. You want to say the last name with me?
Oh, that's okay. You can call me Yasas Hewage.
Hewage. Yes, sorry. I'm a little bad with names and I'm working on that
that's
skill.
That's okay. Yeah.
So Yasas Hewage. A little introduction about Yasas. But before I go ahead, guys, please press the like button so that I know you guys can hear me and you can hear me clearly and you can see me. Please ask me questions as we go through the session so that Yasas can answer the questions live. He's here only for a short period. He's from Sri Lanka. So you're not going to catch hold of him so easily, although he'll be happy to reply whatever questions you have after the session as well. For those who are watching replay, don't hesitate to ask questions. And share this video with people who you think can benefit from this. Tag people in the comments to invite them to see this video. I think it's so, so important to share the new knowledge and the new things you learn with others. The more you spread, the more good things come back to you, because then other people also then spread the message forward. So going back to my introduction of Yasas, he's actually failed his A-levels, but now owns one of the largest study centers in Sri Lanka. He owns a school, which is CIM UK, Chartered Institute of Marketing of UK, from 10 years. He's also a faculty in the school and he teaches marketing. He has got various corporate experience, but he's a passionate cyclist, a racist, or you are a professional into racing and stuff as well. And so he fell in love with cycling again in 2012, and he decided to leave his banking career and start a cycling cafe where you repair bikes, and you also have, that cafe was called the Spinner Cafe in Sri Lanka. Right, yeah. And the fun fact about this cafe was that they sell those special roti sandwiches, which I'm going to ask you, Yasas, sure, as we go through. The cafe is still there?
Of course, it's still there. And yeah, one reason you should come to try those sandwiches.
I know, to try the sandwiches. So yeah, Sri Lanka is in my bucket list, hopefully for 2018. I should make it there one more time. He's also the director for Ironman 70.3, which is due in Sri Lanka in 2018. So Yasas, over to you now. You want to share a little bit of a journey of how, the struggles you faced in failing and in trying to, I'm sure school was not the first thing that you did. You know, started. I'm sure you went through a lot of learning phases of what should I do, how should I do it, which I'm sure a lot of viewers are also going through. What next? Yeah. Where am I? I failed here. Will I be successful? All those fearful thoughts. How did you cope with that? And how did you decide to open the school?
Okay, so that's a lot of things.
Yeah.
If you ask the question of whether I've looked at things as struggles, probably not.
Okay.
Because I had a fairly stress-free childhood. Because my father never asked me to study.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah. So
lucky.
He never asked for good grades. He just...
Did he own the school?
No, he didn't.
My father owned the school, so I was not okay not to study.
Yeah, so I can't say the same thing. Of course, as a growing up kid, we all have our day-to-day challenges. Mm-hmm. But I was never under pressure to perform to certain standards. Or because actually, my father was an education psychologist.
Okay.
So he probably understood how children learn better.
Okay.
So gave me all the freedom to have fun. He said, let this child play. So I played a lot. I had a lot of fun.
Wow. Okay.
Which eventually made me spend more time in the grounds rather than in the classroom.
Yeah.
And then a little bit outside of school without coming inside the school. So that's how you fail your A-levels. But what you really learn out of that whole process is your value system, your attitudes. I mean, you build so much of life skill. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying the classroom doesn't, but I probably learned more outside the class in my first 18 years in school. So yeah, when you fail your A-levels, suddenly it's a reality bite for you, right? And what do you do? So I think that's when I really started getting into formal education.
Okay.
So I stumbled upon... Yeah, and now I had to study.
Yeah.
And I had a reason. I honestly didn't have a reason at school. Why should I be doing geometry? Yeah. Nobody really convinced me, gave me good reason why
you
I should...
Do you feel guilty that all your friends and peers and colleagues, like, you know, all getting they're passing and moving to next grade?
Yeah, every time I went out to meet family, that was the case. My father used to always say, don't worry about him, don't let he never let me be compared with anyone. I think that's a mistake parents.
That's very important for parents to not compare kids.
Exactly. So my mother was a bit more traditional mother who actually kept few things in structure, at least sent me for elocution classes and you know, got some basic grades going. But my father gave me total freedom to just have fun. So I had so much of fun, I finally ended up failing my A-levels. So that was not fun. But then, of course, I took my education a bit seriously because I fell in love with marketing.
Yeah.
I ensured I did that with a lot of passion.
Yeah.
Went on to become a chartered marketer and a fellow at the Chartered Institute of Marketing. Today I teach. So ironically, he probably knew that I will peak at the right time. And today I'm teaching, whereas I was somebody who failed the traditional education system.
It always happens. You know, I was also one of the worst students in my school. And I would be so, you know, everybody is competing and trying to get first and second and third in class. And here I'm not even passing out. I'm like, shit, what is going to happen with me? My father was stressed all the time. He always has some money ready to promote me. Can you bribe the school? And then there was a time when the school said, I'm sorry, we cannot take the bribe. She has to pass.
Okay.
You're not going to promote her anymore. And then it was like forced on me. And I found a teacher who really taught me how to really study.
Yeah.
And that's when I started. Then I just started studying by myself and I started ranking first, second, third in school.
But that's a very valid point, right? Most of the time, we can't find a logical link to what you study in school and why you're doing it. B, the style of learning of children are very different.
Yeah.
And the traditional school doesn't actually match that. And
probably.
Yeah.
I just couldn't understand what they're trying to teach me. Yeah.
So that's the story there. But then that's why I always start with this 1996 where Sri Lanka won the World Cup.
Mm-hmm.
Big high moment. And Yasas fails his A-level. So that's like this. Okay. A happy country and what do I do now? And then I stumble upon marketing. I got my job at, my first job was at HSBC as a teller. You know, that's what you get when you're lucky to get that. And then I found my way through to, 15 years of banking career.
Wow. From teller to, where did you reach then?
Well, I was involved in setting up the cards business for my first bank. Then NDB, I set up from scratch the whole consumer lending business, which became the market leading business for the whole bank.
So you kept growing the corporate ladder as...
Actually, I grew very fast because the value system that was put inside me because of sport, etc., was to perform, and you bring that from the
the
ground.
The competitive edge comes and then that starts applying in every part.
Everything.
Of is it good or bad?
It's a good thing. If you're not competing within something, either with someone else, sometimes in a sport it matters, or with yourself. I think that's why the world is where it is. Right? I mean,
we are all competing with each other.
If the human race hasn't competed in a better living, we would have been probably right now in a cave.
Yeah.
So competition is good. I'm not in this world of it's all about taking part. That doesn't make the world go round.
Okay. So do you pressurize your children to compete?
I don't pressurize.
Not pressurize is the wrong word. Do you like expect them to compete and win?
I expect them to compete with the status quo.
Okay.
Do better than what's already there. It doesn't mean to compare with somebody else.
With yourself.
With yourself. Mm-hmm. But if the competition requires you to compete with somebody else or something else, so be it.
Yeah.
Okay. Otherwise, what's the whole point of playing a game? Right? This is a game. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Most of this is a game. Life is a game. Maybe a few things isn't, which is your personal relationships with these few people.
Yeah.
Everything else. I mean, digital marketing, you got to win or somebody else will win your business.
Yeah.
You know, I'm just going to do it just because it's a nice thing to do.
Yeah.
No, excuse
me. You compete and you got the bid. Auction.
Yeah.
Everything
so
is auction.
I generally say it's a nice thing to say, okay, live and let live. Excuse me. That's somewhere else. That's charity. That's family. That's friends.
Okay.
You come to business. It's like sport. There are winners and losers. Mm-hmm. Okay? At the last race, I lost. End of story. I did try this, that. That's okay, man. But I lost.
Yeah.
Because I went to win.
It's interesting you say that. You know, like I don't perform in competition.
Yeah.
That's one of the reasons my office is in downtown. It's not an internet city or T-com or where most of the digital agencies' offices are.
Right.
Because competition puts me down. It scares me. It puts fear of failure and all that. So I believe that let me compete with my... But I do compete with myself. I try to be better in wherever. Maybe also in childhood, I was compared a lot.
Yeah.
So whenever I was compared, I would de-perform and end up playing the game also. Like, I don't want to play. I'll go home and sit because I'm supposed to, you know, produce results. So maybe that's the phobia that I have since childhood. And it's kind of reflecting in this age as well. So
maybe.
Yeah. Maybe. But then I think when I see all my... I'm into cycling and that's how, you know, I met Yasas as well.
Yeah.
So when I see all these cycling buddies competing or, you know, gearing up and increasing their averages and speeds and stuff, I feel pressured again.
Yeah.
So I this time I want to try to stick up to something at least, try to match somewhere.
But see, that's what I'm trying to say. It's not about, it's that gear you play, use. Are you competing with a particular benchmark set by others? Which I agree. I would not let that drive me. I'll take that decision. When do I go and compete against
X.
a set benchmark? Yeah. But all the time I'm competing within the benchmarks I set for myself. I had a goal when I came here. It was unfortunate. It was very cold. I didn't really expect. Last time I was here, it was in March.
Yeah.
I honestly didn't do my geometry properly, or at least climate. I didn't understand how this part of the world works.
Yeah.
First ride I went that night, it was chilly and I started to cough. So the whole game.
So we are talking about Spinnies 92, which just happened. Yasas actually came to Dubai for Spinnies 92.
Yeah.
So
I was with the Grand Fondo, with the elite riders. So so that didn't work for me. So in that case, I lost. But
you've won races before?
I won a race a few months ago, which was a relay.
So you have won races.
I have won races, okay? But not an elite race like this.
Mm-hmm.
This is a dream for me to get to. My objective was in my age group to hit a top 10 type of performance.
Target. Okay. That's a good objective.
That's a very good objective, looking at the type of quality riders you have here and the guys who come from everywhere in the
world.
All
the world,
So it has been a great one.
Yeah.
But I, realistically, I was asking for too much because 9 months ago I had a broken collarbone.
Mm.
So I'm coming back from a fairly bad position.
Yeah, this is what happens in cycling. It's it's a fun sport, but it's very risky.
Yeah.
Because you have falls, you can actually break your body parts and it takes 6 months to recover.
Sometimes it can be a very cruel sport.
Yeah.
If you're competing at that level.
Yeah.
But this was not even competition. I was just riding with a race to go, with a week to go, and I just fell off my own bike just by overbreaking it. So you can't even blame the...
Yeah.
So I take that risk to be open about the fact that I'm going to win something.
Yeah.
And I'm fine with the fact that somebody will laugh at me. Oh, Yasas, did this, what happened to you? I'm just perfectly fine with it because it's my objective.
Yeah.
I fail, I lose.
Yeah.
What the world thinks about it is good. If it's a positive thing, if it's not, it's still fine. And that gives me a reason to, it drives my adrenaline to go and do better. It's a bit of a risk to be upfront and tell, hey, this one I want to take a podium or I want to do top 10.
Yeah.
The last race I did, I was actually almost on the race line putting a post and saying, I got this one and we got a goal.
Okay.
That's crazy. Okay. Oh. And I know when you psych yourself up like that, your body starts responding sometimes.
Yeah. Is this something works?
Something works.
And I think the same rule applies in business as well. You know, I don't know if you guys heard the words that he's using.
Yeah.
Be open about things.
Yes.
Take risk.
Yes.
Have a goal. Have an objective. Yeah. I think exactly same rules apply in business and in life. And you put those goals ahead and your body will automatically start responding to help you reach those goals.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So
how did the Spinner Cafe come in place?
Yeah, so Spinner Cafe was
after the CIM.
Yeah. So what happens was I was working in the bank, you know, after 10 years of being in a bank, you realize banks do the same thing over and over again.
Yeah.
Since the ATM, I don't think we've done anything new. Maybe the Visa card.
Yeah.
It's not an exciting place to work. It's a great place. There's a bit of...
It's an interesting industry.
It's an interesting industry, but it's not Tesla, which is next door to you.
Yeah.
Or, you know, it's not digital marketing, which is fun. You know, So I mean, if you want to look for a career, I could have, because I was fairly well placed with a 37 years, you've got a bit of time to hang around and hope something happens.
Yeah.
But then by that time I was feeling, I had my school, I was teaching, I was loving that whole experience. Cycling has come to my life in 2012. So I was actually started with a foldable bike to just bike to work, more of an environmental thing, not to race. So we started the whole bike to work campaign. We started a page called Room to get Colombo cycling.
Okay.
We started events and activity purely from a community point of view.
Yeah.
And
why did you need a community? There's a reason I asked this. Because
so,
you know, entrepreneurs and business owners and people, marketing, everybody, people who are into this world or any business world, you feel lonely. You feel alone. And it's so important to have a tribe, to have a community, to have someone like... one of the reasons I'm into cycling is because I have amazing friends, amazing group.
Yeah.
And we all motivate each other. We all, you know, wake each other up and like, we have to go. It's 5 o'clock and you're responsible to show up because you're committed for a ride.
I think you're absolutely right. Maybe it's genes or it's who you are. Some of us, I've probably been somebody who likes to share things with people, like what you're doing right now.
Yeah.
So I found cycling a game and I want to share that with more people.
So you wanted to have more.
Yeah, I mean, it was such a fun thing. And I realized it was 11 years when I got my first bike. Maybe at the age of 18, I lost it and got to the corporate whole rat race.
Yeah.
And I got back on the bike and I'm loving it. And shouldn't I tell this to everyone? So we started a simple Facebook page 2012 called Vroom.
Mm-hmm.
Vroom is idea like vroom, like when you're a kid. There was no logic to it.
Yeah.
And then we just started doing fun stuff and there was no idea for a cafe or a business or anything like that. And it became like a whole culture and people, and there were other clubs emerging. And Colombo never used to cycle in the city.
And now
then,
you cycle.
Yeah, we had that whole thing happening. So that was happening on the side. Banking was banking. I thought, hey man, now is the time. I should just go after my passion to get into more cycling. By the time I started competition a little bit, so I felt I could actually compete, which was never even in the equation.
Yeah.
At all until you do it by yourself,
you
realize, hey, I can actually do what you did, right? So Spinner was just an idea because we had no place to hang around. We were solving a simple problem. We used to hang around under a tree for all the riders to get together.
Yeah.
You know, Colombo is a bit of a not as congested as, you know, Dubai.
It's more open.
So we used to hang around in a tree. There was no place to fix a bike in the morning.
Yeah.
We were at 6 o'clock, like nomads. So I had this land, which was a fairly commercial piece of land. I should have actually built something and rented it out.
Yeah.
They said, hey, let's start something here.
Yeah.
So that's why, you know what cyclists want, right? We need a cafe.
Yeah.
We need a place to fix our bikes.
Yeah.
So I just did that. No market research, no major plans.
Just like for yourself.
That. Yeah, I was the only customer.
Yeah.
And I knew for my friends might come.
Yeah.
But I had my confidence in the fact that I'm a marketer.
Yeah.
And the fact that I can spin something out.
Yeah.
And it was my passion. And I knew I'm going to spend more time here. So I spent about 2 years now. It's almost 3 years.
Yeah.
So it spun a lot around that. By that time, I've got into, because I was competing, I had to study about the technical side of cycling. So
nutrition,
I studied about nutrition. And I stumbled upon a brand called Science in Sport, which was also sponsoring spinnings.
Okay.
I was a customer for that.
Okay.
So I got the distribution of that.
Okay. So you kept growing the business.
Yeah.
There's a very important key takeaway in this conversation here. Yasas started his cycling business for himself.
Yeah.
It was his need to have a cafe. They were standing under a tree. Most of the businesses are, you know, they sprung out of your own need, your own pain.
Absolutely.
So if there is a pain that you are going through and you're not finding any solution, maybe that's the business you should get into, because that's a business idea.
Yeah.
If you have a pain, there's so many others like you who would be wanting the similar or going through a similar pain that you can now solve with your business idea.
Absolutely.
That's how people innovate, right?
Absolutely. And sometimes it's so simple. I'm sure it's even here, if you got a couple of bikes at home and in the morning you want to ride them, you know, you normally find there's no air in it, right?
Yeah.
And that's a whole project to get that done.
Yeah.
Same in Colombo. So we didn't have a place to fix a bike.
Yeah.
So I said, let's do that. So by that time I had found somebody who comes to my home, a very, very experienced mechanic who was coming in a bike to fix a bike and staying till 10 in the night chatting with me.
Yeah.
So I got him in and said, hey, let's set up the whole place.
Yeah.
So we got the cafe going, and then by that time I studied a bit of biomechanics on cycling. I got fairly fascinated about the technology behind that. It's about understanding how your body moves on the bike.
Okay.
So we simulate that inside the environment like this to see whether your power is in the right position, whether you're tilting too much here and there, whether your aerodynamics are working.
Yeah.
So I got that also in as a thing that I would want to do, which put a lovely lifestyle type of center together where you can rent bikes, you can fix bikes, you can get advice on bikes.
Yeah.
And some food that I was from a banking background.
Yeah.
So with, you know, I have a very, very enterprising wife who was also saying, okay, let's have some fun. We had some great ideas about the food and the team there.
Yeah.
Now we crack some fun stuff. There's, you know, the roti sandwiches and have you heard of kottu?
No.
Yeah, that's an amazing Sri Lankan
food. I have
food.
To try this. I have to come to Sri Lanka now. Now I have a friend, so I'm going to make it there.
Absolutely. So we've tried that out. And so the food part is picking. So there are people who are non-cyclists coming there to stop and have food.
Yeah.
So that's my way of trying to convert them into cycling. So do events. So spinners become like a lifestyle space for cycling. Yeah.
Another key takeaway from a little this conversation was he started enjoying the rides. He opened his own place, his cycling studio, and then he started learning more about it. I think it applies again to any business.
Yeah.
The more you enjoy doing it, the more you start learning what goes behind, like what like the biomechanics that you mentioned and the nutrition part of it. So how to eat right. You automatically start going into this phase of going deeper into the business or the idea that you are in and start learning new things.
You've got to do that.
And new skills around it. So you've got to invest in your skills.
Yeah.
A lot of times businesses actually sit back and because the day-to-day life takes over, you forget.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know if everybody has read the book called 7 Habits of Highly Effective People.
Yeah.
And one of the last back habit is sharpen the saw. It's so important to keep investing in your skills, to keep sharpening the saw, to keep learning and growing in the industry you're in, because we are in a very fast-paced growing world. Everything is changing and evolving in such, whether it's cycling, whether it's digital marketing. I read 2 hours a day, every single day, to keep up to what we are doing at work.
You've got to do that. So I fully agree with you. So that's what the E-formula, you know, I'm just...
Yeah, that's where I want to come to. That's perfect.
So the key, it could be, the two E's are entrepreneurship, for employment. These are the two E's we try to grapple with.
Yeah.
Most of us will start as employees, which is fair. I did the same thing. It's a low risk, more structured way of getting into an economic model, right?
Mm-hmm.
And most of us in our back of our mind want to be entrepreneurs someday. You've taken the plunge. Have you been an employee before?
Never.
Oh, okay. You never even know how to apply for leave, okay?
No.
Right. So I know, okay? To how to have a prop. Oh, no. You've got a Christmas coming, there's a project going.
Yeah.
So that's the world,
but
you learn a lot because some of these companies have big knowledge pools.
Yeah.
So it gives you a lot of structure. It's a great place to be.
Yeah.
But some of us are entrepreneurs trapped inside those employment cubicles.
Yeah.
So one of my jobs is to release more and more out to the world.
Yeah.
Especially Sri Lanka needs them badly. We have enough employees.
Yeah.
We need more entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. So whatever the E you want to drive your life with, which is your economic key,
entrepreneurship. So you choose the E.
You got to choose the E.
Yeah.
You need expertise.
That's the second E.
That's the supporting E.
Mm-hmm.
So if the outcome is employment or entrepreneurship, that's the decision you take. But either which way, you need expertise.
Yeah.
Traditionally in our cultures like Sri Lanka, we're not going after expertise. We're just trying to get a bit of education, bit of experience. They're not really putting that together to build an expertise.
Yeah.
So that means you have to, as you said, you got to start investing
in yourself.
In yourself. So I believe in three E's that helps you to get the expertise. So education, which is not about just qualification, but continuous learning from people, from books, from events, from experiences. So your education cycle has to keep moving. And sometimes not costly, as you said. 2 hours didn't probably cost you MBA. It just cost you your time and a book that you picked up, right?
Yeah.
So this E is critical. So I've invested from a banking life, which I was investing on banking education, from whatever it was, books about new banking laws and rules and, I don't know, credit appraisals and, you know, all those fancy stuff. I started investing in education in cycling.
Yeah.
So I got myself qualified from Brazil University on biomechanics.
Okay.
I read a book probably a month. So that my whole investment on the expertise with regard to education moved to cycling.
Yeah.
And that gave me an advantage there.
Yeah.
Then the E number two is your experience.
Yeah.
Every race I go, every event I go, that's your experience. Every client you work with, you got to now put the E experience in.
Yeah.
Sometimes we keep switching from one to the other and etc. And we don't add that in. But both those E's doesn't mean anything if you don't have exposure.
Yeah.
So you got to get yourself into unfamiliar situations, markets, industries, and figure out more exposure. Because 10 years of experience means nothing.
If nobody knows about you.
Not only that, if you've been doing the same thing over and over again. I mean, if you've been making soap for 10 years, it's a great thing, nothing wrong with it. But don't expect your life to change because you're a soap maker for 10 years, man.
Yeah, unless you innovate there.
Unless you go to Flex or powder or tablet.
Yeah.
So the whole idea is fine, even if you take a pay cut or take a risk, even if it's inside the company you're in, find room for exposure.
Yeah.
You got to find exposure. So example, I took, while working in the bank, I took 2 weeks off and went to see Tour de France.
Okay.
Okay, for my own money. And I went behind the Tour de France. I went to the back end of it. I was with the organizers. I saw the whole of Tour de France. How does it really work? I never realized I'll be sitting in a team organizing Ironman 6 years from that.
Yeah.
Which is an extremely complex event.
Yeah.
The logistical nightmare of having 680 cyclists swimming and coming onto their bikes and then running and working with a global company. We've got a couple of very partners who are capable, ex-Olympian and Ironman.
Okay, we are back. Sorry, we had a little bit of interruption in our in the conversation. Something happened to our life. So going back, do you remember what we were talking?
I don't know. We're talking about exposure.
Yeah.
So if the formula I was talking about.
Right? I just want to make sure everybody, guys, I hope you guys can see us. Just press the like button so we know that, yes, everything is live back again. So going back to exposure.
Yeah, so if you're looking at a formula, which has worked for me, is if you've got to build expertise in whatever you are focused on. So education, which is continuous, which is obviously. But sometimes we forget the fact that education can be a book that you read and a channel that you're subscribed to. Like you said, right, 2 hours, you've got to be really focused on that.
Yeah.
The experience that you need to have in the industry that you are focused in is critical. But we always forget the power of exposure. Getting yourself into events and programs and exhibitions. I was giving the examples of myself being at the Tour de France to understand one of the most complex cycling events in the world. So, so that type of exposure helps you to build an expertise that's difficult for even competition, if you're competing in a business line or industry, to knock you out because you're continuously investing in building an expertise. What most time people do is they either do on education or they totally rely on experience or they've just had ad hoc exposure. They don't combine that very well.
Yeah.
So that when they present themselves, even for a pitch, they would have the needed expertise to back.
So you mean to say that it's not only to have the education, but the experience that goes with it and the exposure of going to the right kind of events, and understanding what others are doing in the industry and having that kind of exposure towards your job that you're in.
Helps for sure.
Which is very rightly you say, like, we go a lot to digital marketing conferences. I travel to the US and go to these conferences and learn from our peers who are doing very well in those markets.
Yeah.
And then we bring those knowledge and technicalities here and try to apply to brick and mortar business because the West is too much into info products and stuff like that. So you have to invest. You have to go out there and you know, spend time with the right people who are in the game.
Absolutely.
Doing 100 times better than you.
Yeah.
Like Tour de France. Like it's huge. It's a big event. Huge. I don't know how many of you here know about Tour de France. It's one of the biggest cycling events of the world.
Yeah.
And cyclists from all over the world go there for to take part in these races. And it's huge. It's huge. When we hear the cycling, I'm into cycling, and we actually religiously watch the whole every day, the whole race. So yeah, we have our favorite cyclists, Chris Froome and whoever other, you know, Mark Cavendish and stuff like that. So yeah. So going back to now, we had education, expertise, and exposure.
Yeah.
What else? Do we have any other E's to cover?
Yeah, so I mean, the E that finally makes this whole thing happen for you is you find your excitement. Excitement means some would call it passion. So
even passion has to be before, right? You were passionate about cycling, which is why you got into cycling.
That's for sure. It's a funny thing. Sometimes your logic has to help you find your magic. Because if you're in a corporate world, most people are, you might not get that perfect job or the perfect boss. And people read a bit of extra Robin Sharma and start getting philosophical and get lost. Versus say, hey buddy, you got to find excitement in whatever you do until you find that little spark. It might not happen overnight. But I was a teller, and I found a spark being a teller. I enjoyed that. I figured out ways to balance my cash faster. I was trying to be better than the guy next. I want to clear my not have a single cash out at the end of the day. It's a positive outlook to life. Find excitement in whatever you do. I know it's an easy thing to say, but it's an outlook to life that you got to find excitement. Otherwise, you're going to drag yourself down the drain and you'll be a wreck.
But what do you do if you don't like what you're doing?
Then you got to find something else.
But then your family depends on it. Your livelihood depends on it. There's so much fear of not able to find. Nowadays, job market is tough. Market is generally tough. Economy is tough. Just go through the grind. Keep doing it.
Honestly, I haven't been in that position to answer that. But I've had bad bosses. I've had bad years in a bank. I've had policy changes that I was totally against. But maybe it's me. I haven't done a massive research on this. But there's always something in your job.
That is good.
There is something that there can't be something that you don't either.
Like.
That there has to be something. Maybe it's about the coffee you get or the chat you have with the coffee lady in the morning. There has to be something.
That drives you to work.
That drives you to work and helps you to have that conversation. It could be the fact that. So that's one part. The other part is there should be some excitement outside of work. That's where you might not really enjoy your first 8 hours of the day. But you might still have something to do after coming. Maybe your gardening, maybe your bonsai, maybe your dancing, your Zumba. Something else, because this is like the ultimate, the last line of defense. That doesn't let your engines just drain away. Because of work, doesn't cut it. Bad time, bad market, bad situation. You're in the verge of probably going down. But there's something else that you know is
something
exciting.
Something that drives you in life.
Sometimes it's kids for some. It could be some. There is something, that's for sure. It might be the plant that grows in the backyard. That is blossoming. But you got to find that in. And then once in a while in life, you might find that unbelievable spark that I found in cycling. I got back on a bike and said, oh man, this is something I want to do. Because I rather climb mountains on a bike than climb balance sheets and P&Ls for somebody else's bank. And then you start building a business around it and great things happen. I never planned for Ironman relationship. Met some amazing people, like-minded. And hey, we got a new thing happening. And it just happened. So this is a search that happened over, I don't know, 10, 15 years, and you find it. But you got to find that E for excitement and somehow figure that out in your life one way or the other. Otherwise, it's impossible for you to even find a positive moment in life, even to get your next promotion or the deal, because you're down. So you got to find that E for excitement. And the final E I came from cycling is endurance, which means you've got to hang on.
You gotta hang on.
I mean, when I started Spinner, I mean, there were no customers. How can there be customers? This is made for me. Then I realized, hey man, this is a hobby business. I'm taking a lot of my time, but I had what it takes to hang on as a cyclist. You know, right? You will find a group. It's a matter of time. Somebody's gonna come. There is going to be some tailwind. In the 90 kilometers, just hang on. And it happened, right?
It happened,
so you learn that in the game of endurance, there will be moments that's going to keep you, drag you along the system.
You know, I want to share a little bit of my own story. Like, just a couple of days back, we had Spinnies 92, and this was my second time. The last time when I did Spinnies 92 last year, it's been 2 years I'm into cycling now, but this year has been really seriously dedicated into the sport. So I have a weekly goal where I do 100 kilometers. I put in at least 100 kilometers a week so I can get trained.
Yeah.
And my gang is mostly men. So all of these men are really becoming stronger by the day because of the food and whatever, the stamina. And I'm still weaker. No excuse there. I still need to invest in my own, in do more gymming or maybe make my muscles more stronger, eat proper food, not indulge in my coffees. There's lots I can improve on. All these are the thoughts I was thinking when in this race, and on Friday as we started, my group disappeared in like 5 minutes. And usually in cycling, you are drafting, so it's much easier. When you are behind another bike, it's about 60% easier for the person who's behind to spin. You don't have to work that much hard because the person in the front is actually taking all the wind. And a lot of times we are heading into the wind. There are a lot of times when the wind is behind us, so it's a tailwind, so we roll and we fly. So we have good and the bad moments on a ride. And as we rolled, as I said, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go, my group just vanished in front of me. I'm like, shit, I have 9 kilometers to go. One of the guys did hang behind, but then it was selfish of me to keep him behind because I was not able to spin as fast. My heart rate went up to 172. I couldn't spin much. I had to, you know, reduce my speed so that my heart rate could come down. I could stop gasping. I would, you know, pick up my ride and put in a harder gear and everything. I'm giving you all these specs to understand what goes in the back end of a ride. And then I was like, you know, there are cutoff times. So if you don't cross that path or that road, because in Spinnies 92, there are various important roads of Dubai which are blocked for cyclists to pass. And if I didn't cross that cutoff time, then I would be just ending up doing 50 kilometers, which is like a fun ride. And I really, this time, my only goal this year was to finish the ride, whether with people or alone. I don't care about the speed. I just wanted to do it. And as I lost all my group within the first 1 or 2 kilometers, I had 90 kilometers to go. And I started thinking, all these thoughts started coming to me. Namita, you need to stop eating food. You need to start working out more. Maybe I stop eating croissant that I eat every week. And I started, my other mind started preparing me that, you know, it's okay. Maybe this year we'll not make it. Maybe next year we'll make it. Let's try to finish it this year at least. Let's at least give our full. So even then, you know, there was a little part of me that was scared that I might not reach the cutoff point alone. I kept going. I kept sprinting and going. There were so many groups passing by. And I couldn't latch on to them for whatever reason because they were on a higher speed. I needed a proportionate speed. But then eventually, after about 50 kilometers, I met someone on the, you know, we were crossing each other, and then I met another group, and then we were together. So like you rightly said, you have to keep going. And the moment when I saw that the roads were open to do the 92K, the 53 cutoff came, and the 92 cutoff came, I cannot tell you the happiness I had. I wanted to actually jump out of the bike to be happy. Yes, I'm doing 92. And I just kept going, and there was so much. There were times when the legs would burn, they would just burn. I'm like, God, please give me power. And I didn't want to stop for a single second because I wanted to keep reaching my cutoff times. I didn't want to miss out the roads. So they would really burn, and then there'll come a sprint downhill or something that'll be relaxing. So always moments in life, just like on cycling, in cycling, that there will be uphills, and then there'll be happy downhills, and there'll be a headwind, and there'll be a tailwind. I think it's part of life. It's part of business.
Absolutely, yes.
So
no big out of the box formula, but it's the fundamental principles. But I think you made a very clear point at the beginning. Deciding on your goals is going to be critical.
Yeah.
Most people are not clear what a goal means.
Yeah.
I find that at the highest level of companies also, right? People call goals, objectives, aims. They're confused.
Yeah.
Now a goal, I don't know whether we can both agree on it, is the direction you take in your business or life.
Yeah.
So I had a goal to build my career, life in the banking industry. So that means my direction is in that. That's my goal.
Mm-hmm.
But when I change it to cycling, sports related,
mm-hmm.
then the goal changes. So you start investing everything mm-hmm. in a different avenue. That's a big decision.
Yeah.
Sometimes we are not bold enough to take these goals.
Yeah.
And end up doing a lot of things in a lot of places.
In between.
I call that getting half pregnant. You can't. You got to make a decision. Okay. where am I investing? Am I investing in South Asia? Am I investing in Europe? Am I investing in small business? Am I investing in digital marketing? Or am I investing in content development?
Yeah.
Where what's my goal? Okay,
yeah.
Where am I going to be an expert in 3 years or 2 years from now?
Yeah.
And then really start investing in that.
Yeah.
So while I am an organizer of Ironman, which is a triathlon,
mm-hmm.
I have no intention of learning swimming.
Okay.
I have all the reasons to go and do that now, but I won't, because that's not my goal. Organizing Ironman and doing a triathlon is two different things.
Okay.
My investment will be as a sport in cycling.
Mm-hmm.
In marketing, right now, my investment is in digital marketing.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll be reading a book a month.
Mm-hmm.
I'll be doing something every day about it. I have to keep moving because
yeah.
I'm building my expertise in the area of marketing, but in digital marketing. Because I have a couple of businesses which requires that. I teach digital marketing. So I got to keep
learn
my focus
it, yeah.
there, right? I'm not going
to... Put the education and the experience,
right?
In it. Yeah.
So one reason I said yes to you,
yeah.
apart from the fact that we are friends on cycling, hey, you're somebody from digital marketing. It's a good idea to connect.
Yeah.
We are in business. I don't know where it connects. We don't have immediate requirement
yeah.
to business.
Yeah.
But it makes sense for me to connect with somebody. If you say I'm from a research company, I would have still come and have a chat with you. But I came with more purpose because I can learn more from you because you're a digital marketing person.
Yeah.
If you open my laptop bag right now, there'll be a book on digital marketing inside that.
Yeah.
So I'm fine. Okay. Mm-hmm. And I got free coffee from you.
Yeah.
And we're friends.
And we have a good
so
conversation.
It's a good conversation.
Yeah. Yeah.
So with me,
yeah.
this conversation on a holiday is exactly down my
goals.
Path on my goal.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's what it means. I mean, what you meant. If you
yeah.
want to take a decision in 2018, you're going to take a call. Okay, I'm going to be a runner.
Mm.
Triathlon is sexy. Cycling is crazy. It's fun. But what do I want to do? I want to run a half a marathon? Then let's start running.
Yeah.
Okay, don't subscribe to any nonsense. Don't go and look at those books out. It's not for you. It's you have to take that decision.
Yeah.
So that's the type of call you need to take. It sounds a bit cruel, maybe. But if you want to win somewhere, you want to be established someplace, you've got to take that decision.
You need to have these goals set
yeah.
in.
So the goal, if just to tick on that, the goal has to be converted to an objective. I know this is MBA stuff, but you got to be specific. What do I do when?
Yeah.
By
smart goals.
Yeah, you got to make that smarter, achievable,
yeah.
agreeable, all
yeah.
that time bound.
Yeah.
And then you should have a KPI on a daily basis.
Yeah.
Your two-hour thing came there, the
yeah.
key performance indicator.
Yeah.
Okay, I need to go to the, you know.
Like for example, in
yeah.
my cycling,
yeah.
I have to bring in 100 kilometers a week,
exactly.
no matter
so
what. My whole life is around the 100 kilometers.
So there you go.
I have to do it.
Yeah.
So I can't meet my friend for coffee because I have cycling
yeah.
today. I cannot go for that night out because I have cycling tomorrow.
It
happens.
It
I'm antisocial because
it
of
happens.
My these goals.
It happens.
So
otherwise you wouldn't even have...
And I've lost friends because of this, actually.
Yeah, but found new ones, so...
Yeah, found new ones, absolutely.
Yeah,
yeah.
So,
yeah.
so that there's no secret to this. I think
yeah.
I'm from a small business point of view. If you just talk to somebody who's built this big building out here, I'm sure it's the same principle.
Yeah. I think
so
logic applies
logic
everywhere.
Applies everywhere. So
strategy is the same.
Yeah. So my experience from banking to a total 360 degree change to cycling,
yeah.
It's the same principle. So
yeah.
yeah.
So some key takeaways for 2018. So be very specific of the goals you want to achieve, your personal goals and your business goals.
Yeah.
Invest in your, choose what you want, whether it's entrepreneurship or employment.
Yeah.
Invest in your education, expertise and exposure. Attend the right events. Invest
yeah.
in your skills.
Think of expertise. What do I want to be an expert on?
Yeah.
And then couple it, support it with education, experience and exposure.
Yeah.
Those are your three gears to achieve expertise, as per me. Okay.
yeah.
Yeah. So that's
makes sense.
Yeah. So
and then bring in the excitement.
Bring in the excitement, the little magic dust and
yeah.
the gold dust into it,
yeah.
sprinkle it here and there.
Yeah. And the
yeah.
last one is the
hang
endurance.
On,
hang
on. Start cycling.
It's not going to start cycling.
Yeah.
It's not going to be easy.
Yeah.
Any path. You know, there is going to be a part of the new job or whatever your dream venture is or whatever you're currently doing, there will be parts which are not going to be fun. But you have to keep doing it because the non-fun part are also going to lead to fun part.
Absolutely.
I'm sure there are a lot of things in cycling which are not fun, but you
yeah.
have to, you know, you have to keep doing the gig. It's not always going to be goody-goody.
Yeah.
So on this note, I would like to, you know, thank you, Yasas, for coming on the show from on your holiday, on your vacation, giving me a little bit of time. I hope all of you guys enjoyed the session. Don't forget to ask questions if you have any. Me and Yasas will watch the man this video. If you all of whoever is watching a replay, do press the like button and the love button if you really enjoyed the video, because that's how we come to know that whatever we are doing, whatever I'm sharing, you're actually liking it. And do tag people in the comments below to invite them to watch these sessions. You can also find our previous sessions in on our website above digitalacademy.com, or you can just scroll down through my Facebook page. You can find this page facebook.com/ramani.namita. You can just scroll down and find all the different amazing sessions I've had with amazing thought leaders and entrepreneurs in this region. So get that objective going. Reflect this year. This is the best time to reflect on the year 2017 and start putting down some good goals, whether it's personal goals, your fitness goals, your business goals on paper, and make a plan backwards of what you will do to achieve these goals. You know, they say, there's a saying, you aim for the sky, at least you'll reach the moon. Or is it you aim for the stars and you'll reach the moon? Something like that.
Yeah.
Whatever the saying is, you have to aim somewhere and you will reach at least somewhere. I know how many of you make vision boards. I highly recommend, like I believe in all these things. And last year I made a vision board and I've reached about 60% of the things on the vision board. So invest, you know, do whatever technique, whether it's a mind map or a vision board or just writing on a piece of paper, whatever works for you. Just make that happening for yourself. And I hope you have a wonderful, wonderful 2018. A very happy new year and a very Merry Christmas to all of you. I'll see you guys early next year. We are planning our new lives and I'll be announcing the live very soon on my page. Until then, hang on there, make your goals and start rolling. Have a good day. Bye.